Mark chapter 3, beginning in verse 20. Then he went home, and the crowd gathered again so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, "He is out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, "He is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of the demons he casts out the demons." He called them to him and said to them in parables, "How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, the kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. Truly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they were saying, he has an unclean spirit. And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And the crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking about at those who sat around, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit, we do ask that you would enlighten our hearts now, and that you would lead us in your ways, and that you would speak to us. For the sake of the one whom you represent and wish to honor, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our passage in Mark is Mark's first instance of using a literary device known as intercalation. If that's too hard for you, it's very easy to remember, and it's very important to see. What Mark is doing is he's sandwiching. Sandwiching. Here's what I mean. If you look at our text, I'll just show this to you. Our text begins with Jesus' family coming. They're coming to seize him, and then all of a sudden, Mike, it just breaks down, and he goes into this story that we all know and are all afraid of and are all wondering what it means that relates to the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And then in verse 31, Mark comes back and he concludes what he began in verse 20. We have a number of these sandwiches in Mark's gospel. Let me show you a couple of them just to, as an example. If you flip a couple pages or one page in your Bible to chapter 5, this one you all know very well. This is when Jesus, beginning in verse 21, Jairus comes over to him, and Jairus asks that Jesus would come and heal his daughter. Verse 23, and implored him earnestly, saying, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her. And Jesus begins to go, and what happens? The woman who is sick, who has that unceasing blood flow, sort of breaks up the flow of the story, and Jesus is forced to heal her. Now, notice this very important thing here. Jairus' little daughter is sick, and he wants Jesus to heal her. In verse 34, look at what Jesus tells this woman. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed from your disease. Jesus is healing his daughter, his spiritual daughter, from the disease she was facing. And then the story concludes with Jesus going and raising from the dead Jairus' daughter. You see that sandwich there? If you flip a few more pages over and you go to Mark chapter 11, again, there's a couple others that I'm not going through, but I just want to point these out so that as you're reading Mark, by the way, this is included in other synoptics as well, and the Gospel of John, these sandwich techniques, and I'll talk about them in just a moment, but Mark chapter 11, I want to show you another example of this. Mark 11:12. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry, and seeing in a distance a fig tree and leaf, he went to see if he could find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And the disciples heard of it. And if you remember, the next scene, by the way, this is true in all the three synoptics, the next scene is Jesus goes to the temple and cleanses it. After he's done cleansing the temple, verse 20, they passed by in the morning and saw that the fig tree withered away to its roots. Sandwiches, this technique of sandwiching or intercalation, is very purposefully. It's not just by accident put there by the author. It's meant to draw your attention that the stories presented are supposed to help you interpret one another. In other words, the meaning of one is fulfilled by the meaning of the other one. Very often, the stories carry the same theme: the care for the child in the healing of Jairus' daughter, the barrenness, the fruitlessness of Israel's religion compared to the barrenness and fruitlessness of the fig tree. So what is the theme that binds our text together? What is at the heart of what is going on here? And I would want to draw your attention that the focus here is not so much on the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, though that is an important component, and we'll talk about it without a doubt. What is most important here is what happens at the end of the story. And that is Jesus looking about him, looking at those who are sitting next to him, and saying, "This is my family." In other words, this sandwich is meant to communicate something to us about who are and what is the family of God. And as we go through the text, I think we're going to see how it relates quite a bit to us about our perception of what it means to be close to Jesus, of what it means to be one of Jesus' own, of what it means that we are, you and I, are the family of God. Now, I want to push you as we are thinking about this. I want to just put this question out there. One of the things we need to be doing is we need to be thinking about how does this relate? And what does this have to do with the Holy Spirit and with the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? So let's just kind of walk through our text. What we encounter, first of all, is we encounter the opposition by the family. The opposition by the family. Look at verse 20 for me. "Then he went home, and the crowd gathered again so that they could not even eat." This happens right after Jesus was up at the mountain where he called his disciples, if you remember, where he commissioned these men so that they would be with him. They would go out, they would preach, they would cast out demons. And he returns home. Most likely this is in Capernaum. This is not where Jesus was originally from, which is Nazareth. This was up north. And Jesus is in Capernaum, most likely in Peter's home, the same place where the man came with the crippled person. They broke the roof. And so people know this is where Jesus is to be found. And the crowds gather and they're less than helpful. Jesus could not even eat. And so verse 21, "When his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, he is out of his mind." So the very first thing we see here, the opposition by the family, has to do with the fact that his earthly family considered Jesus insane. This is not a comfortable or an easy text. People who were closest to Jesus, in fact, if you turn with me, who is this family? If you turn to Mark chapter 6, let me read you, who is this? "And on the Sabbath," verse 2, "he began to teach in the synagogue." Verse 1 says that he went to his hometown. Verse 2, "he began to teach in the synagogue. People were astonished. Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense with him. Now look at verse 4. It was not just the synagogue officials. "And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household." The family of Jesus, when they hear about all the things that Jesus has been doing, when they hear about his casting out of demons, when they hear about his battles with the local religious leaders about the Sabbath, they are afraid of what this is going to mean for their family, of what this is going to actually, how people are going to think about them. Why do I say that? It's because, as you know, in that Middle Eastern culture, actually in the ancient times and now as well, it's an honor-shame culture, and your kin, your family members, are the most important unit. If your family happens to be ashamed, or one member of your family happens to be ashamed, it impacts the whole lot of you. You lose your standing in society. You lose your opportunity for worship. In fact, if you remember John chapter 9, we have an example of this. You remember what happens in John chapter 9? Jesus heals the blind man from birth. Remember that story? And the Pharisees are wondering, who did this? He says, Jesus did this. They're in confusion. They're not liking this. They go to his family, and they ask his family, who healed your son? You remember what the family said? He's old enough. You go ask him. Why did they do that? If you read John chapter, John chapter 9, verses 20 to 23, John 9, 20 through 23, it says, because they were afraid of the religious authorities, because the religious authorities decided that whoever was for Jesus was going to be cast out from their assembly. So Jesus' family is afraid that this is what's going to happen to them as well. In fact, what they're really afraid of is they're afraid of that Jesus was going to be classified as not simply insane, but as one who is demon-possessed. They're actually afraid of what happens in verse 22. They're afraid of that happening. How do I know that? If you turn with me to John chapter 10 for a moment, I want to show you. In the ancient world, insanity and demon possession was very closely tied together. They were separate, they were different, but one was very commonly followed by the other, or considered to be followed by the other. John chapter 10, here we have the conclusion of the whole, here we have the conclusion of the whole instance with Jesus healing the blind man. In chapter 10, he talks about the fact how he is the shepherd, he's the good shepherd, how he is the door to the sheep. 10:19, there was a division among the Jews because of these words. Many of them said, he has a demon and is insane. See that connection? He has a demon, is insane. If you ever read that, you wonder, why are the two connected? Because in their minds, the two were connected. He has a demon, is insane. Why listen to him? Now his family comes, and Mark uses some very interesting words. He says, and his family came because they wanted to seize him. That word seize is to forcibly take by force and imprison. To come and take somebody against their own will. In Mark 6:17, John the Baptist is arrested. In Mark 12:12, the same word is used when it says that the Pharisees, they wanted to arrest Jesus. In other words, his family's pretty worried about him, and they're pretty worried about how this is going to all end up. And so they consider him to be insane. Now, not only that, as we continue reading this story, verse 22, the religious family judged Jesus to be possessed. And the scribes who came down, verse 22, from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of the power of demons, he casts out the demons. Some of you maybe have read this, and you, just as a side note, you're saying, how did they come down from Jerusalem? Jerusalem is south of Capernaum. Jerusalem is built up on a hill. So whichever direction you go from Jerusalem, you always go down, whether it's north, south, east, west, it doesn't matter. Jerusalem was up on the hill, so that's what it's talking about, that they went down because Jerusalem was up on a hill. And things really have heated up here. Up until this point,
the quibbles that Jesus is having, he's having with the local religious magistrates. He's having with the local religious magistrates. Now there's a whole delegation from Jerusalem that has come down, and they have judged that Jesus is possessed. Notice here, they're not denying the fact that Jesus has done miraculous things. They're not denying that there is some supernatural power within him. They can't deny that, so instead they reclassify it. They explain it away. They actually try to throw mud on Jesus. If you can't battle it, you label it as something else. You label Jesus as being demon-possessed. How is he doing these crazy things? How does he have this teaching? Well, he is possessed by Satan himself, and it is through Satan that Jesus is able to do all of these things. Now notice here, what's super important to see is that both of these groups ought to have the insider track to be part of the family of Jesus, to be part of the family of God. Jesus' family grew up, they saw him, they saw the life they lived, they saw how he grew up, they saw the love of God manifest through him for 30 plus years before he began his ministry. I mean, who? They should see, they should know, they should know that he's God. The religious leaders are those who study the Bible, who know it very well, who are the keepers of the sound doctrine, and they happen to be the ones to say, this man is possessed. The reason he's doing these things is because Satan invades his life and Satan is working through him. Now that's, in one way, ought to be encouraging to us. You may wonder, how's that so? How's that encouraging? Notice here that it is not miracles nor proof of life that is needed for somebody to have eyes open. Sometimes we think, if somebody says, prove to me that God exists. Probably heard that. Offer me some proof. Look at this. The Pharisees had proof. The Pharisees had proof, and they said this was demonic. We have our own explanation for that nowadays, right? When we show supernatural things happening. Naturalistic explanations. Not only that, right? Somebody says, well, if the church was not so hypocritical, it was not so corrupt, there was not so much sin present, then I would truly believe. Well, Jesus' family could have not said that. Right? They could have not said, I would really follow Jesus, you know, if he wasn't such a hypocrite. But they look at what he claims and what he wants and who he says he is, and they say that he is insane. How does this give us hope in our faith? How does this give us hope for those around us who are not believers? Well, for one, I think this makes the songs that we sang, such as like, he will hold me fast, so precious. None of us came to Christ because we, through a lot of our own wisdom and insight, have been able to study the details of the doctrines of the Christian faith and been able to a T prove that this is the best way to go. It's because the Holy Spirit had opened up our eyes and he has called us to faith. And therefore it gives us great encouragement because the same Spirit will hold us fast till the end and make sure that we don't fall away, whatever happens. Not only that, but that I think gives us a lot of hope for those around us, especially those who are very close. Some of whom I know have been hurt by the church. It gives us hope because we know that no amount of their argumentation, such as hypocrisy against the church, or amount of their sophistication with their intellectual arguments, philosophical, scientific arguments, it gives us hope that when we pray, that can actually work. In fact, only when we pray, only when God acts, can people come to faith in him. Now this also reminds us, this serves as quite a stern warning to us. Quite a stern warning to us that we can be very close. We can be so close to Jesus. We can be so close to the Christian faith. We can be so close to the kingdom of God and yet be so far away from it. Now, this is especially true for some of us who are second, third, fourth generation Christians who've grown up in the church and who by the mere reality that you were prayed for, right, when you were 2-3 weeks old or whatever, by the mere reality that you've never missed a church service, by the mere reality that maybe you sing in the choir or something, you are automatically in with Jesus. This text is a very significant warning because it says you can be living with Jesus for 30 years like his family. And still, when you truly look at the teaching of Jesus, you ignore it. Probably very few of us would say Jesus is crazy. But I know, if I know my own heart and if I can interject my own heart on you, sometimes some of the things that Jesus wants and says and demands, they don't seem like they would really work in the world. I'm like, Jesus, have you heard yourself how this would sound in the 21st century? With lying? I mean, how else do I get by? Or love? Love towards neighbor? I mean, you don't know how vile this person is. And we can be looking and seeing and thinking what Jesus demands of us and consider that to be pretty crazy. God forbid that anybody would ever label us as Jesus freaks. We don't be all crazy like that. So this passage is a warning. By the way, it also serves as a preparation for what will happen to Jesus. How do I say this? Why do I say this? It's because when the Pharisees, when these scribes, when they label Jesus as demonic, it gives them the right later on to do all that it takes in order to get rid of him, even break their own law in terms of lying about Jesus to lead to his crucifixion. Now, what is Jesus' response to the family? So we have the opposition by the family, by this his religious family, and by his earthly family. How does Jesus respond to them? First, he points out the danger of the unforgivable sin. The danger of the unforgivable sin. Verse 23, and he called them. So he hears what the Pharisees are doing, or the scribes are doing, how they're saying that he is doing this by the power of Beelzebul. He called them to him and said to them in parables. In other words, he's going to show them how illogical what they're suggesting really is. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. In other words, he's saying, what you're suggesting is that there's civil war going within the realm of the satanic. Don't you realize that what you're saying is actually that Satan is causing his own self-destruction? By the way, Jews had a lot of history with internal strife and conflict. Do you remember? Do you remember that after Solomon passed away, do you remember why the kingdom split? Because there was an internal strife in the kingdom. His son, Rehoboam, and Jeroboam, who was one of the commanders, they got in a fight, and it resulted in the splitting of the kingdom and the weakening of the nation for many years to come. Not only there, during the Hasmonean dynasty, which is during the Book of Maccabees, in that 400-year period of quietness, when two people, Aristobulus II and Hyrcanus II, were fighting for the throne, Pompey in 63 AD came in and without any opposition virtually took over Jerusalem. So the Jews would pick up what Jesus is saying here, they would pick up on this, and he's saying, what you're suggesting is actually pretty dumb. It's not possible that Satan is causing strife within his own kingdom. Well, if it's not Satan, look at verse 27. No one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods. Notice here, he doesn't make light of who Satan is. He's talking about him as a kingdom, and he's saying, but, another in contrast to being a civil war, a strife within the kingdom of darkness, He says, no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed, he may plunder his house. In other words, Jesus is saying that he is the stronger man come from the outside, who is able to plunder Satan's house. He is able to come into Satan's domain, Satan's home, and he is able to set free those who are captive. Now you may be wondering, why does Jesus use this illustration? Why is Jesus talking about this illustration about the stronger man coming and plundering the goods of another? Whenever you're in the Gospels and somebody asks you that question, a very good answer is to say, because the book of Isaiah says so. In Isaiah chapter 49, if you want to turn there, this is what Jesus is referencing with that imagery about the fact that he is the stronger one. Isaiah 49, look at what God promises. He's talking about his people, and he says, can the prey, talking about his own people, talking about the Jews, be taken from the mighty, or the captives of a tyrant be rescued? Can my people who are taken captive, who are taken captive by the mighty, who are enslaved by the tyrant, can they be rescued? Verse 25, for thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken, and the prey of the tyrant be rescued. Why? For I will contend with those who contend with you, and I will save your children. In other words, this passage, just like many others that we've studied in the Gospel of Mark, speaks about Jesus' self-understanding as God come in the flesh. Who is stronger than the strong man? Who is stronger than Satan? Only God is. And Jesus says, I am the one who has come, and I'm able to overcome the strongest one and plunder his goods. Now, here's where we get to the very interesting part about the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Verse 28. Let's look at this passage. Truly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they were saying he has an unclean spirit. This passage has generated a lot of debate among Christians for a long time. And apart from the debate, it actually has generated a lot of uneasiness in the lives of many unbelievers. I'm sure there's more than one of you who, in some time during your life, has wondered, some low point in your life, have I committed the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit? Is there no hope for me? And let's look at it in historical context, what it means and what it means by application to us, and tie it in into how that relates to the rest of what is going on here. In its historical context, it has to do with something very simple. The reason why Jesus is turning to these scribes and saying that you are committing blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is because they are, quite simply, they're attributing the works of Jesus to Satan. In other words, they're looking at everything they saw, the teaching of Jesus, the exorcisms of Jesus, the healings of Jesus, and they are saying, what is empowering that is not God, but Satan. And Jesus is saying, through that, you are committing the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Now, this is interesting because the Holy Spirit does not play a very seemingly dominant role in the Gospel of Mark. There's actually not much said about the Spirit. However, at the very beginning of the Gospel, we see that Mark is setting it up where Jesus is baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then it's the Spirit who drives the ministry of Jesus. Spirit is the one who drives him into the wilderness to battle Satan. Now, the word blasphemy means to slander or defame or to speak ill of someone or something. very often in the New Testament, it has to do with speaking ill of God, blaspheming against God. Now, given that historical context, many people have said that this is actually was only possible during the lifetime of Jesus. So this was only possible for these scribes, for those people who were present, who were able to witness, and then say, this is what, you know, this is of Satan. It's a possible reading of this text. However, I do think that what Jesus has in mind is not a particular sin. In other words, blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is not a thought or a word that you could say to commit. I do think that Jesus is talking much more about a state a person enters. And the reason I think that these are connected here with his family and now with the scribes is that it shows a certain progression and there's a warning there. One step is what his family is doing, where they're looking at him. They're not saying that he's possessed, but they are saying that what he is doing is crazy. They have reason in order to reject him. In the Gospel of John, we're told that his family did not believe in him. That's one step. The next step is where your opposition to Jesus kicks in into high gear, and you begin to say that now, as with these scribes, you enter into a state of where you say Jesus is actually driven by Satan. Theologians across the ages have recognized that the role of the Holy Spirit in salvation is central because the Holy Spirit is the one that gives us faith, that quickens our heart to believe in Him, the one that regenerates us, the one that connects us to God the Father, adopts us into His family. And what Jesus, I think, is saying here is that people who are looking at what Christianity is and people who attribute it to Satan, they're the ones that have no hope because they would never think or consider or even decide to turn in order to ask for forgiveness. This is why I do think that Jesus says any blasphemies, whatever blasphemies will be uttered, whatever it may be, whatever sins, right? It's talking about sins will be forgiven, children of men, whoever blasphemies they offer. In other words, whatever they do, it can be forgiven if they turn to Christ and allow the Holy Spirit to forgive them. However, if they label the Holy Spirit and the work of Jesus as being satanic, they have no hope. Why do I think so? You know, what's interesting is that if you read the book of Acts, you will find that among the early believers of Jesus, we have Pharisees. In other words, we have those who potentially sent this delegation. Again, we don't know for sure, but they're specifically identified as being early followers of Jesus. Not only that, the best example of this is the Apostle Paul himself. In 1 Timothy 1:13, Paul says, "I was a blasphemer." I was a blasphemer. And if you read Paul's life, he really did think the reason he persecuted the church so strongly was that because he thought that Christianity was evil and wicked and a perversion of the Jewish religion. We don't see Paul trying to persecute other pagans, but we see Paul being ferocious in trying to close down the faith. And when in 1 Timothy, Paul writes about himself, he says, "I was a blasphemer." The reason I bring this up is that I want to highlight this idea that what I think Jesus is highlighting is that you can't enter in a state of opposition to the Holy Spirit. A state of where you close yourself off from any opportunity for Him to witness and work in your life. And that is that. That's why Jesus' response is the danger of the unforgiven sin. In other words, if you can't have the Holy Spirit work in your life because you call Him Satan, you cut off yourself from any opportunity to be forgiven and to come to Christ. Now, what does this mean for you, for me? First, we nowhere see in the Bible anybody who has ever tried to come to God and God saying, "Sorry, 5 years ago, you blasphemed the Holy Spirit. tough luck, I can't forgive you because you did this one sin. Nowhere is that found in the Bible. People who have blasphemed the Holy Spirit, they could never even think of coming because this is satanic. Like I said, it is a state rather than an act. Secondly, only God knows the entire course of a person's life. And so the only sure proof that someone has blasphemed the Holy Spirit will come on Judgment Day when the hearts of all people will be revealed. In other words, when we read about this, and you've probably heard about people coming from satanic cults, repenting and becoming believers. Where in satanic cults, there's actually specific practice of worshiping the devil. And even out of that, God can lift you up out of. So that means we have no right to ever label somebody as having blasphemed the Holy Spirit and saying they're outside of God's help, outside of God's any assurance. We don't see the heart. We don't see their state or what they may seem. And God can bring them out of anything. Thirdly, maybe most importantly for you, anybody whoever is worried about that is in itself an absolute proof of the fact that you have not blasphemed the Holy Spirit. Because if you are concerned over that, then you're showing that you don't think the Holy Spirit is satanic. You don't think the ministry of Jesus is empowered by the devil. Just because you had a thought, or maybe you've fallen into some deep sin, you know, I think in our Russian culture specifically, certain sins are almost labeled like the sin of blaspheming the Holy Spirit, adultery being one of them. That's without a doubt, that's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Such a person can never be restored. That is not true. That is not right. That is not biblical. So in other words, if you are concerned, that's a very good sign that you haven't. And Jesus, whoever comes to me, I will never turn away. So how does this relate to us? Let's keep reading. Verse 31, and his mother and his brothers came. The story resumes the sandwich, the second part of the sandwich. And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? Verse 35, and looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. So Jesus' response is one, that there is a danger of the unforgivable sin, which is you cut yourself off from the life of God, comes through the Spirit of God, which then manifests itself in reality of not being part of God's family. And I think this is what's really right. Jesus, imagine this scene, right? His mom and his brothers and sisters are out there. And Jesus, in making a point, he says, who is my family? Who really is related to me? Who really is mine? Is it people who have family ties to me? Is it people who have biblical knowledge, per se, who know the scriptures? Who is it? In other words, Jesus is saying that those people who reject him or any part of his work, any part of his identity, any part of his will, really are not part of the family of God. And they are all standing in danger of resisting the Holy Spirit to the point of where they cut themselves off for any opportunity to be reconciled to God. This reminds us of the fact that in the world, there's only two types of people. In the world, there's only two types of people. There's those who are part of God's family, and then there's those who are on a hill sliding ever further away from him in their opposition to him. Whether that would be by ignorance or whether that would be by active suppression of the truth that they know, that they have heard. And this really puts us, me and you, into the fact that how much are we concerned for those people and of their fate? How much do we plead for them, for God? How much do we look at them in such a state as those who are on their way to the unpardonable sin, to where when they stand before the throne of God, there will be no intercessor before him. Those who want to have a claim, authority over Jesus, they could never have that. What we see here, if you remember in Mark chapter 3, verse 14, Jesus called those whom he wanted. It's those who would be with him and those who would be doing his will. We see the absolute reverse here. His family is outside. His earthly family is outside. And they want to control him. And Jesus is saying, who is my family? It's those who are inside who want to follow me. So, point three, this is where we'll end. The invitation for the family and us. What Jesus really is doing is he's turning to this family, this extended family, which is his earthly family, his religious family, and all who were sitting there, and he makes one explicit and one implicit invitation. Here's the explicit invitation. Verse 34, and looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. Here's this explicit invitation. Join the family. Join the family. You don't need to be related by blood to me. You don't need to have a certain standing in society. You don't need to have a certain IQ. You don't need to have a certain life that you have lived. You don't need to bring anything. All you need to do, and for some of you this is uncomfortable, you need to do the will of God. Well, you may wonder, what is the will of God? What is Jesus referring to here? There's only one command, really, in Mark's gospel up until this point. It's fascinating. Chapter 1, this is, what is the will of God? What does Jesus have in mind by the will of God up until this point? What do Mark's readers know that the will of God is? 1:15, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Look at here. Repent and believe. Repent and believe the gospel. What is the will of God here? Who does the will of God? It's those who have recognized that they are by nature not part of the kingdom of God. You see, the Jesus family, the Pharisees, they assumed that automatically by their standing, by their closeness, by their proximity, they were part of the family of God. So they had nothing to repent of. They had nothing to think of. And Jesus says, how do you become my family? You do the will of God. What is the will of God? It's for you to repent and believe. In other words, it is for you to realize that you are not part of the kingdom. That's what repentance is. It's coming to Christ and saying that I'm not part of your kingdom. I have sinned against you. And then it is to align yourself, your whole life, to define you now, not by your ethnic standing, not by your educational standing, not by your material standing, not by any other standing, but by the fact that you are now related to Christ. In John chapter 1, I'm sure you remember this text. Very beginning. Verse 11, he came to his own people. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So this is a call for those of you who are not part of the family of God. Those of you who are not reconciled to God. Those of you who are outside. Join the family. Join the family through repentance and faith, through your allegiance to Christ. What about for you and me, for those of you who have become part of the family? This is Jesus' second invitation. If you've joined the family, now live as family. Live as family. I think this is an implicit command of Jesus. The body of Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit, is meant to unify us and make us into one whole. We are the family of God. What kind of a family are we? Are we the type of family that those looking outside in say, you know, Lord, save me from such a dysfunctional family? You know how some of you, when you look at certain families, you're like, I'm very grateful that I was not born in that family. And then there's other families that you look at and you say, oh man, that family really had something that I didn't have. I wish I would have been part of that. When Jesus says, who's my family? Those who do the will of God. Implicitly, he's replying and he's saying, live as a family of God. If this is what the kingdom of God is, those who have believed, those who have entrusted themselves to, then what kind of a family image are we projecting? Is it one that is filled with unity, acceptance, love, help, care, concern, freedom, assurance? Or is it one that's filled with pockets of people who are on their own pages, who are building their own sub-culture, sub-career, sub-kingdoms within the family of God? In Ephesians chapter 5, just to give you one direction to think about this, I wish I'd have time to actually go through the whole section here in Ephesians. Chapters 4 and 5, I could leave you that for your home if you want to think about what does it mean to be part of the family of God. Chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, they hold these two sections. They really hold chapter 4 and chapter 5 together. It says, therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children. God loves all of his children equally as a perfect father. And walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. In context, this is not talking about love to God. Read the context. Read 4:25 and downward, talking about what kind of words we say to one another. Talk about how we resolve conflicts. Talk about how we deal with each other in terms of business transactions. Talk about what goes on inside of us. Bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, slander. Right, he's talking love. Live as a family of God, as beloved children. Walk in love. A family of God is what I titled my sermon. Family of God, those who have been born of God, are those who have joined the family through their repentance and allegiance to King Jesus, and who then live under the power of the Spirit in unity, love, and care for one another. Whether you've read Mere Christianity or not, I'm sure that you have heard this quote from C.S. Lewis. Let me put it up for you just for a moment. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of thing Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. And I do think Lewis is writing this because he, after probably meditating on Mark chapter 3, verses 20 through 35, he would be either a lunatic, hey, that's what his family thought. He would either be a lunatic on a level with a man who says he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. As you think about the family of God, as you think about the teaching of this text, what will your response be? Will it be to continue to walk away and resist him, and thus resist his family, resist his spirit? To be outside of where forgiveness and reconciliation with God is possible? Or will you turn to Christ? The other option, dear friends, is not to nod in agreement. The other option is not to nod in agreement, because demons believe and shudder, but is embrace the reality of you being the child of God and us being thus the family of God, and to pursue living the life of love that God calls us to. What will your response be? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your love towards us. We thank you that you have made us your beloved children through your Son. We thank you that we have been placed into one family. And this is a dysfunctional family so often. And while we can't get away from all the dysfunctioning and sin and hypocrisy to which we contribute, we can strive to do the will of your Son, as we call him Lord and Savior, to live a life of love as the family of God ought to be characterized by love. We're thankful, Jesus, that your Spirit who gave birth to your family, who made us one, is the one that lives inside each and every single one of us and is able to make this possible. It was your Spirit that made you able to overcome the world. It was your Spirit that made you overcome Satan. It was your Spirit that made you able to go to the cross. And it's that same Spirit that now lives inside each one of us. We ought to not just be able to speak of the power of the Spirit, but experience it and exemplify it as we are united as your family. We pray these things for the glory of Jesus Christ. Amen.